Hi, Mickey.
Hey, Bob.
How you doing?
Okay, I can't believe you don't want to talk about Jean Benet.
Yeah, I would like to keep this a Jean Benet free zone for eternity, if that's possible. I'm pretty sure that there's enough coverage out there to keep anybody who's interested in the subject more than satisfied.
Fair enough. But I've already broken the barrier by mentioning her.
You have. But so, we will stop that.
I was hoping that would annoy you more than it did.
We will stop that cancer before it spreads.
Okay.
So, well, listen, at the end of the show, we should say a very heartfelt goodbye because there's a chance that tomorrow Iran will initiate the apocalypse. This is kind of a prediction of Bernard Lewis's made in the Wall Street Journal. You know, he's the kind of neocon house intellectual.
Well, right, and the Iraq War was very much his baby, I believe.
Supposedly. I mean, he's a professor, I guess emeritus of Middle Eastern Studies at Princeton, and supposedly he was trotted out to convince Dick Cheney to invade Iraq. I've always had trouble believing that Cheney needed much in the way of convincing, but anyway, something that Lewis said about the nature of Islam and the nature of modern Islamic discontent supposedly was somewhat influential somewhere in the circles of power.
Well, supposedly they brought him back for a second meeting where he said, "Why haven't you invaded? Hurry up already."
Is that right? Is that the story?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Well, anyway, now, perhaps in an attempt to shore up his credibility, he's making a kind of a prediction. I mean, he's noting that tomorrow, if you look at what August 22nd corresponds to...
It's the 10th anniversary of welfare reform.
That too, although he neglected to make that point, believe it
That's
or not, Mickey.
That's not a big deal, okay.
But we will of course have some festivities, I guess, toward the end of the show. For that reason, no. He said it corresponds on the Islamic calendar to a date when the Prophet took his so-called night ride or night journey. And here's what Lewis says. First of all, earlier he says, it seems increasingly likely that the Iranians either have or very soon will have nuclear weapons at their disposal. Actually, he's the only person I'm aware of who thinks there's any chance that Iran has nuclear weapons now, but apparently he thinks they may have them already. And then he goes on to say...
Jackie Shire would not agree with that.
No one would agree. No one. Yeah. I haven't heard anybody say that there's even a chance within a year. But anyway...
They could have bought an old Soviet nuke.
We all could have. I may have nuclear weapons, maybe.
It would be insane for them to start
But actually, he goes on to say in this sentence, I don't have a quote here, as a result of their own production, whatever. I'm almost positive.
Okay.
So anyway, he says, regarding the date, this might well be deemed an appropriate date for the apocalyptic ending of Israel and, if necessary, of the world. It is far from certain that Mr. Ahmadinejad plans any such cataclysmic events precisely for August 22nd, but it would be wise to bear the possibility in mind. And indeed, he titles the piece August 22nd. Now, of course, he's here kind of trying to... He's stressing that he's not predicting it for sure, you know.
But if the world blows up, he wants credit.
Right, exactly. But you can't have it both ways, right? I mean, if this is a predictive statement, and I assure you that if Iran initiates an attack on somebody tomorrow... He will point to it as a sign that his credibility should be enhanced, and all neocons will, and they'll say we were right about the apocalyptic nature of this regime. Well, okay, but if you're going to play that game, you know, there's no free lunch. It has to be the case that his credibility will be somewhat diminished if there is no attack by Iran tomorrow, right? That makes sense.
Well, somewhat, but yeah, but he's allowed to say, I'm scared for this reason or that. I mean, that's...
No, he's allowed to say that it's not a 100% sure prediction. Well, and that means that his credibility will not be ruined if it doesn't happen. That reduces it on both ends of the equation.
I mean, certainly Ahmadinejad has been trying to build up this date, hasn't he?
Trying to build up what?
The date of August 22nd.
Well, they said that August 22nd is the date on which they will reply to the UN kind of ultimatum.
Well, why isn't that enough?
Well, I don't know, but that's not all he's saying. He's saying they may initiate the apocalypse, okay? August 22nd. By the time our viewers see this, it will be just about August 22nd. Some of them will be seeing it later, and they'll know. And I don't know. Maybe he's right. All I'm saying is his credibility should be at least a little diminished if it doesn't happen, because surely it will be seen as having been enhanced if it happens.
I would think his credibility is more diminished by the Iraq War.
It's already lower than it was, say, a few years ago, yes. And I'm just hoping that we can get it a little lower.
Okay.
But enough about him.
It would be very foolish of Iran to start the apocalypse before they can actually bring it about, no?
Well, he thinks they may have nukes now, but yeah, I would think that some kind of conventional weapons attack would be... Although if they understand the dynamics at play in the world, they may think that we're on a slippery slope. In some ways we are, and that they could... I think a conventional attack of a certain kind actually might well hasten epic global turmoil. Yes. Could be done, even without nukes, I think.
Huh. How would that happen?
Well, I mean, just look, we saw what happens when you kill a few Israeli soldiers and kidnap two. I mean, a lot of things were set in motion.
Right.
So I'm thinking if you launched an actual nation-on-nation attack on Israel, there could be a chain reaction of events that would lead to really bad stuff. Like the true, something that looked much more like a clash of civilizations than what we've seen so far, although God knows we're getting closer than I'd like to.
Meaning Israeli attacks on Iran and Syria? Something like that?
Maybe, but you can certainly imagine things that would wind up, I don't know, you could see coalitions form and fighting break out and regimes... forced to choose on the Arab side. I mean, I hadn't planned to talk about this. I haven't thought about it. I don't know. But regimes that are deposed for failing to side with Iran and or are forced to side with Iran to avoid being deposed. I don't know. You tell me.
You're talking very vaguely like Ahmadinejad. But anyway, you weren't prepared to talk about
less
this.
Colorfully.
Well, actually, this leads to our first subject because one of the panelists on this week with George Stephanopoulos was, I don't know how to pronounce his name, Raoul Marc Gerecht.
I've never been able to, but he's a good dresser.
He's a good dresser. He's a natty dresser, and he sort of agreed with me that the outcome of the Lebanon War, which the CW is Israel came off very badly in, points toward an attack on Iran. In his case, it's sort of to remove the taint of defeat. We used to be worried that, Arabs would have to attack to save face. Now I'm sort of worried that Israel has to attack to save face and to prove that, its military reputation is still intact.
Well, he, of course, favors an attack on Iran by somebody, right? He's at AEI, and that's
yes,
one
and
of
he,
their goals
well, he,
in life.
He actually speculated that it would lead to an attack on Iran by the United States.
In order to shore up Israel's credibility, we would...
No, that Hezbollah has pissed off President Bush, and that Bush would take it out on Iran because he's mad at them. That was his basic argument.
I've heard a little speculation along those lines.
And, he just met with President Bush, so it's not like he's completely talking through his hat.
Mm.
He knows if Bush is mad or not and what he's mad at. So it had a certain amount of credibility that otherwise it wouldn't have.
Maybe Bush will initiate the apocalypse tomorrow.
But I don't understand why we would attack Iran when we couldn't let Israel do our dirty work. Probably better than we can, maybe.
Good question, although doubts have recently arisen about Israel's vaunted military.
Edward Ludfock has an interesting piece, which is an attempt to puncture the conventional wisdom on Lebanon, where he basically makes a couple of points. First, after the 73 war, there was jubilation in the Arab world because Egyptian soldiers had behaved very bravely in the war and it surprised Israel and given the lie to Israel's vaunted military machine, yet with as the years went by, perspective was restored, and it was basically not seen as an Arab victory. The same could easily be said with Lebanon. Nasrallah is making a big deal about how brave his soldiers were, but Lutzbach points out they weren't as brave as the Egyptians, who were fighting Israeli tanks in the flat desert with handheld rockets. And also, the reason Israel didn't attack full bore was because Hezbollah's rocket attacks were so ineffective. If they killed more civilians in Haifa and elsewhere, the Israelis would have felt compelled to launch their full-scale war.
Well, but remember, they did declare as their goal early on to wipe out Hezbollah. That's what they said they were going to proceed to do, and they apparently thought for a while that they could do it from the air, largely, and that turned out to be wrong.
That's a good point. I don't quite know what the why Albert, used that ridiculous rhetoric about wiping out Hezbollah. Lutzweig points out, you couldn't wipe out Hezbollah anyway because Hezbollah is a political organization, not just a military organization.
Yeah.
The final positive upshot, which I think he points out, is that precisely because Hezbollah is a political organization, they can't go around starting another war immediately. In other words, they are now rebuilding southern Lebanon, and their credibility comes from rebuilding southern Lebanon and doling out this cash to people. And if they start another war that results in all these buildings being destroyed again or more buildings being destroyed, that sort of undercuts their credibility as the political organization that represents these people living in southern Lebanon, which is sort of an interesting point.
Yeah. Well, I think I said last time I thought that they would be reluctant to, now that the people have returned to the cities, I thought Hezbollah would be reluctant to stir things up. They are, everyone seems to be complicating the situation right now, okay? I mean, there was this UN resolution that was supposed to lead to the demilitarization of Hezbollah, certainly within this zone of southern Lebanon. Hezbollah is refusing to disarm, and then the Lebanese seem reluctant to push them on that point. Meanwhile, the Europeans, who were supposed to send in all the international forces, are balking, especially France, kind of inexcusably, I think. I mean, the logic seems to be that the UN resolution, given the nature of the UN resolution, they're reluctant to send many troops. Well, they're the ones who hammered out the resolution. They knew what the resolution said back when the expectation...
I thought the resolution got changed and watered down.
Well, it did, but they did not at that point dispel the expectation that they were going to lead this international force. Now they're dispelling it days later.
Right.
But meanwhile, Israel is saying they will not accept troops from Malaysia and Indonesia because they have not diplomatically recognized Israel. So it's unclear kind of who, where these international troops are going to come from, what's going to be the deal with Hezbollah. Demilitarization doesn't seem to be in the cards. And then Israel launched this strike that was denounced by Kofi Annan as a violation of the UN resolution. Israel says it was trying to interdict arms shipments, although in Israel there's a lot of speculation that that's actually not what it was about.
It was about killing some Hezbollah commander, right?
Either that or possibly retrieving the two kidnapped soldiers.
Right.
In any event, it was a strange... Apparently, Israel was not necessarily planning to publicize it. It was one of these top-secret things. The commandos were dressed up in Lebanese army uniforms and speaking Arabic and kind of waving and saying, hey, we're here. And they thought they were going to be able to slip through, and it didn't work.
But surely Israel's allowed to try to rescue its hostages.
Well, I would say if this resolution were showing any signs of sticking, I'd say two things. That it's really an ill-advised time to launch that kind of venture. As for the arms interdiction, if that's what it really was about, I would say the smart thing for Israel to do, just in terms of its own self-interest, would be to present any evidence it had that arms were being shipped and saying, if this goes on, we're going to do something. Because, there's no chance that whatever arms shipment it was going to upset was going to fundamentally change the strategic balance. Vital to intercept this particular shipment. And the most obscure criticism I'll make, you will not hear this anywhere else, I'll bet, because this is really obscure. It does seem to me that by dressing up in the uniforms of Lebanese soldiers, you're somewhat undermining the integrity of the actual Lebanese forces that are supposed to preserve order there. If word gets out among the Shiites that any given Lebanese soldier may actually be an Israeli commando, I think that could undermine the effectiveness of the Lebanese force.
Luckily, they weren't fooled.
What?
Luckily, they weren't fooled.
Well, no, but the word may still be out on the Shiite street. Anyway, as I said, that'll be the most obscure criticism you'll hear of that. But
would it be such a terrible thing if the ceasefire fell apart and Israel got a couple more whacks at the apple?
That's such a benign way of putting it. A couple more whacks at the apple. Yeah, and then they can play pin the tail on the donkey.
Well, you know what I mean.
Yeah. I would not be enthusiastic personally. I mean, it seemed to me that... well, first of all, I don't see what good it would do Israel. I mean, it seemed to me that...
Well, if Hezbollah's, now crowing around the Arab world about how we stood up to Israel, and Israel, gained some symbolic victories, that sort of dulls Hezbollah's luster, no?
Well, if Hezbollah is making that claim stick in the Arab world after absorbing several weeks of really pretty severe punishment, I mean, I actually think, Israel got in some serious blows. I don't see how another couple of whacks at the apple, or however you put it, is going to fundamentally change that. Now, if Israel wants to go in on the ground and really go house to house, I still don't think that would be probably in the long run productive from Israel's point of view, given the fact that this is a force with sympathy all throughout the civilian population that they'd be fighting. They could then maybe actually wipe out the infrastructure on that side of the
Lebanon. Well, I mean, right now Hezbollah's not disarmed, okay, and they're in southern
Lebanon.
Yeah,
but a couple more whacks at the... I mean, a couple more weeks was not going to do it.
No, I meant if, Israel would then launch a full-scale invasion and actually remove armed Hezbollah from southern Lebanon, which means that they would be in a worse... Hezbollah would be in a worse position than when the war started.
Well, I think the way... I mean, again, if you don't buy the idea that Israel's big strategic problem is how much it's hated in the Arab world, in the Muslim world, and how many people are willing to die to harm it, if you don't buy the idea that that's a big problem, maybe you're right, but or if you just think that, well, there's already as much hatred as there could possibly be, and I don't buy that either, you can always increase the number of young males who are really willing to die to harm Israel. But if you don't buy that logic, then maybe you're right. There are other possible side effects that could harm Israel. But that's the kind of a large part of the issue.
Well, isn't the most troubling aspect of this? There are all these stories about how Islamism has triumphed, and it's sort of overshadowed the Palestinian cause. So the two-state solution no longer looks like a solution to the Arab-Israeli crisis. These guys don't want a two-state solution. They want to wipe Israel off the map. They're not going to fall for this two-state con where they accept a little Palestinian state and in exchange accept Israel.
Wait, who's not going to accept it?
The Arab world.
Well, I think all that ultimately matters is whether if the Palestinians say, yes, this is what we want, I think the Arab world is going to be hard-pressed to say, no, you don't. I mean, and the problem has been failing to come to terms with the Palestinians.
Well, all the Palestinians are never going to say that.
No, but if the majority vote, if there's a referendum or something at least, or if there's a government, and we finally got a democratically elected government, and because it was Hamas, and again, we've been over this, I think it was a big mistake to immediately, just cut Hamas out of the dialogue and cut off their funding.
But do you think that stops Hezbollah if Hamas says okay? Hezbollah says okay, well, I guess Israel...
Well,
exists then?
Well, if you get a deal with the Palestinians, then Hezbollah is a separate problem. I mean, that's the northern border. And, the trouble is they're becoming the same problem because we're not solving either one, and we've allowed Hezbollah to stand up and act like the champion of the Palestinians, even though it's really harming their interests. And so more and more the Palestinians do feel aligned with Hezbollah,
well,
even though I think that's a bad idea.
You just said the problem isn't borders. The problem is millions of young Arab men willing to kill themselves to destroy Israel. So securing the southern border is not the key. The key is stopping that. And I don't really see how the Palestinian state cuts the number of young Arab men who want to wipe Israel off the map. It's still an excrescence and an insult to the caliphate.
Well, first of all, far and away, the largest number of young Arab men who hate Israel so much they're willing to die for it, I think the highest concentration of those far and away is among the Palestinians. And they have this long-standing and, in some ways, legitimate grievance. And even if the failure to resolve the grievance has lain as much on the Palestinian side as the Israeli side. So if you solve that problem, I think that's a big piece of it. But no, look, it's true that we are turning the hatred that Israel faces into a bigger, more widespread, more far-flung thing, even going beyond the Arab world. And I would add that a lot of it translates into hatred of America as well. The problem is definitely getting bigger. But the core of it, once upon a time, was a Palestinian issue that never got resolved. And even now, I would say that is absolutely separable from the Hezbollah problem. But no one on either side is doing the things that you would do to separate the two. George Bush isn't, Olmert isn't, and God knows Hezbollah doesn't want to separate them.
Okay. We've reached the limits of my minimal knowledge of the Middle East.
You want a possible silver lining or some possible good news?
That'd be good.
Well, on the issue of demilitarizing Hezbollah, at least partly, at least, you know, kind of subduing the military presence on that side of the Litani, if the Lebanese government wanted to try to do it, there is one thing the Lebanese government has to offer Hezbollah, which is that Shiites are currently underrepresented, vastly underrepresented, in the political system because the voting stuff, whatever, the laws are based on some ancient census or some inaccurate census. But anyway, the Shiites are like 45% of the population, and they get something like, I don't know, 20% of the seats in parliament or something in that ballpark. And this is one of their main grievances, even though they've been venting their grievances on Israel, a certain amount of their grievance is an intra-Lebanon grievance. And if Hezbollah extracted from the Lebanese government more equitable representation in the political system, there's a chance, I don't know, that they might be able to give something up. Remember where you heard it first?
Not their arms. They're not going to disarm for an extra 10%.
Well, they're not going to disarm totally, but they might well, like, move their arms on the other side of the Litani or decommission some and move the rest. I mean, I don't know.
Okay. I'll take what I can get. In terms of
I wish
goodness.
More people felt like that in the world, Mickey.
Moving to other potentially depressing news, there was all this skepticism on the web recently that the terror plot that to blow up these 10 airliners was overblown. It wasn't as big a deal. It wasn't imminent. There was Andrew Sullivan took up this cause. There was a major blog post by a guy named Craig Murray, who's a former British diplomat, who basically says, I'm suspicious. I think, you know, this is all because Tony Blair and George Bush needed another 9/11. And there's been a lot of controversy over the timing also. Did they bust the cell too soon, claiming it was imminent in order to somehow serve Bush's political interests? That seems completely implausible to me, because if Bush wanted another 9/11, he wouldn't want it now in August. He wants it in October.
Right.
And the idea that it was done to dull Ned Lamont's victory in the Connecticut primary is completely ludicrous. On the other hand, you know, I thought Bill Clinton bombed the factory in the Sudan in order to distract attention from Monica Lewinsky, so I should certainly be equally skeptical of George Bush.
Yeah, we'll get to that subject later.
And
the way you apportion your skepticism in partisan terms, we'll get to that later.
In Newsweek's cover story, I'm amazed they did a cover story on this while Isakov was on vacation, but they did. They point out that the Brits actually suspected Bush of blowing the cover of an operation too early for political reasons a couple years ago. So I wouldn't put it past Bush. I just think it doesn't make sense in this case.
Yeah, no, I don't buy those kinds of... I don't buy the true conspiracy theories. I was, when I read the post by that former Brit diplomat, there was one thing that led me to believe that the plot has been somewhat overblown. And that was when he said most of these guys did not even have passports. And Andrew Sullivan noted that. Yeah, I think he said most, maybe some. But in any event, then today, when the Brits finally did say they're going to press charges against 11 of the 23, I thought, well, maybe the 11 are the ones with the passports. Some of them were drawn in. Some of them should, you know, they don't have the goods on. But if there were, you know, 11 people with passports would be enough to do some real damage. So I don't know. I mean, if you read the post, that guy's post, the Brit's post.
Craig Murray.
Yeah. Couldn't have said it better. It's somewhat persuasive. It doesn't get me to the point of conspiracy.
It's less persuasive on second reading.
Oh, okay. I'll read it a second time.
He obviously, this guy Craig Murray, obviously has it in for the Home Secretary Mr. Reed, who was on This Week yesterday, acting very weaselly about the whole plot, saying, it looked like a plot in the past tense, and it was there was definitely an alleged plot here. It's basically what he said. So he sort of gave credence to the skeptics. But this is what Craig Murray says about Reed. It is worth introducing Reed, a hardened Stalinist with a long-term reputation for personal violence. And basically, he says he was a commie in college who beat people up who didn't toe the party line. And now he's home secretary.
That does have the perverse effect of actually discrediting Murray, in my view.
Yeah, I mean, he does seem to have a bee in his bonnet about this guy, Reed.
But, I mean, I will say, I mean, my reaction, in a way, for me, the main question is, did we overreact? There was some sort of plot here, I'm convinced. The question is, did we overreact? I thought we overreacted even back when I thought the plot was, you know, vast and imminent. And I still say that, because, and, you know, Matt and Ross on the previous dialogue got into this a little, but, you know, to the extent that you massively dislocate millions of travelers, you have given the terrorists a small victory. I mean, I assure you, they're sitting there saying, yeah, well, okay, the plot got foiled, but we must be pretty important guys if we've got, look at the footage on CNN of all these travelers massively inconvenienced. I mean, if that's what a failed plot does, wait till one succeeds. I really do think that gives them a little kind of positive reinforcement, and you got to ask yourself, how necessary was this? I mean, I gather the deal was that even in America, liquids were kind of immediately banned from carry-on luggage. Now,
yes.
Now we had all the guys involved in the plot, and maybe more, it turns out, we had locked up. Could there conceivably be...
The answer is we didn't know we had all them locked up.
But it was going to originate in Britain. It was clearly that kind of... That was the whole idea. It wasn't going to originate in America.
You mean we should only have banned liquids on transatlantic flights from Britain?
At the most.
That's a good point. Apparently, the best explanation I could see is that, you know, we panicked when they discovered that one of the guys worked at Heathrow. People thought that when we arrested this guy in Pakistan, that one of his compatriots said, "Oh my God, the ringleader's been arrested. Proceed with the plot." And then that panicked us. And, you know, who knows what this guy said when he allegedly broke under interrogation. But, people were, I guess, we have this whole Homeland Security apparatus that seems designed to sort of panic and you know, apply Cheney's 1% solution theory, which is if there's even a 1% chance of something happening, we shut everything down and worry about... worry later about whether we've overreacted.
Yeah, well, again, though, I mean, shutting everything down is a victory for the there's all kinds of ways to give them little victories, and one of them is, you know, this is revived discussion of implementing ethnic profiling in an explicit way, and, you know, my view is that could exacerbate the problem, make homegrown terrorism more likely.
But I think it's also so revived discussion of ethnic profile that maybe the Islamic... self-appointed Islamic organizations will have some sense drummed into them.
What do you mean?
Stop kvetching about profiling.
Why? You think what you?
Because if they were you know, middle-aged Jewish male terrorists, I would not object to being singled out for strict scrutiny. In fact, I am singled out for strict scrutiny anyway.
Well, I applaud that policy. But you admit that there's at least a chance. Okay, well, let me read you from a New York Times article about the fact that in general Pakistanis are able to coexist with mainstream society much more easily in America than in Britain. Okay, here's a quote.
Okay.
A more important factor in determining who becomes a militant is most likely the feeling of being stigmatized as less than equal, community activists say, noting that such discrimination remains far more common in Britain. Now, you know, obviously ethnic profiling encourages that sense of stigma. And I'm not even saying I'm sure that on balance it might not be worth factoring it in to some extent. What drives me nuts is that no one seems to even acknowledge that this isn't a very important question, that it could have this downside. I mean, yesterday on two news shows, okay, McLaughlin Group and the Fox News Hour, there were discussions, each of which included at least one card-carrying liberal, Eleanor Clift and Rand Beers. Is it Beers or Beer, anyway?
Beer. I think Beers.
On Fox, and they had discussions of ethnic profiling. Everybody said, yes, we have to do it to some extent. Nobody even brought up the way in which it could massively backfire by making American Muslims feel more alienated and increasing the number who are going to be willing to or inclined to commit terror. And if you don't think that's a real risk, I just think you don't have the slightest understanding of human nature.
No. I think it's a real risk.
Part of the discussion.
In the panoply of things that piss off enough people that they want to kill us, it's not.
I don't think you understand human psychology. I don't think you've ever been in, felt at the bottom of a social. I don't think you've ever been at the bottom of a social ladder. I don't think you've ever felt, alienated from a social system. I don't think.
But it's not clear that Arab Americans are at the bottom of the social ladder. They have a higher than average income, for example.
Yeah, I know, but you
they're
would be
not unsuccessful.
The candidates for this, the people who would be pushed over the edge for this by this, would be people who had, for whatever other reasons, were already feeling a little alienated. That's the subset of the population we're talking about.
Right, but it's worse if the whole ethnic group feels it's at the bottom, and I don't think that's true of Arab
Americans. The more who feel it, the worse. Look, America's definitely better off than Europe in this regard. You're right. I mean, they were better educated immigrants coming over. They're more, and that's one of the reasons that they're more affluent than a lot of the Muslim population in Europe. Fine, we have that advantage. Let's don't blow it by panicking. And I just got to say, when we, on the basis we just did it, ban liquids from flights originating in America, okay, I don't trust our judgment on things like ethnic profiling. It seems that we're just prone to overreact.
Well, see, it's not racism, it's panic.
It is panic.
So that's exculpatory.
No, it's not, because it's going to be perceived as racist by the people who are the subjects of it, Mickey. We're going to have the people at the airport say to them, "Don't be offended. We're just panicked. We're not racist."
I agree that it's a factor that should be taken into account. On the other hand, it does lead to the standard anti-Bob Wright argument, which is which Instapundit made, I believe, which is, if the Jews beheaded people, we'd suddenly be sensitive to their concerns, too. That you wind up being exquisitely sensitive to terrorists because they might hurt us, and we're not sensitive to, we punish people who aren't terrorists by being insensitive.
So that's positive reinforcement.
If only they started killing millions of people, all of a sudden you'd say, can't offend them.
I think there are things that are perceived as positive reinforcement by terrorists. I mean, for example, the way we got the troops out of Saudi Arabia, this was one good side effect of the Iraq War, is that it allowed us to, this was one of bin Laden's main grievances, it allowed us to get troops out of Saudi Arabia in a way that nobody noticed, so it didn't seem like a concession. If after 9/11 we had just said, we got to get the troops out of Saudi Arabia, that would have been positive reinforcement. I agree. But similarly, to just not implement ethnic profiling, to just not do it, is not going to be taken as some major concession because we weren't doing it beforehand.
Anybody who listens to you will realize it was a major concession because you're exquisitely concerned with not doing anything that will upset those sensitive Muslims because they might turn around and blow us up.
Mickey, on the other hand, I assure you that the smartest people in the jihadist movement, including bin Laden, if we implement ethnic profiling, they are going to celebrate because they understand that their goal is to get us to overreact. Just as they celebrated when Israel started lobbing, started bombing everything they could find in Lebanon. It's overreaction is what they want, and they're getting it from, they're getting a lot of it from Bush, and that's positive reinforcement.
I don't think it's a big deal. I don't think they'll have a big celebration. And also, you can do profiling under the guise of a multi-factor analysis, so we consider all sorts of factors. And I'm always singled out for scrutiny because I buy one-way tickets at the last minute.
So they
think I'm a risk.
What I'm saying is a sufficiently relevant and powerful factor that when neither Eleanor Clift nor Rand Beers even brings it up in the course of a discussion, you know, to card-carrying liberals, we are in serious trouble because we're not thinking about this rationally.
Okay. I accept your attack on Eleanor Clifton Rand Beers.
Thank you. But, you know, they wanted to provoke me, and they'll take it as positive reinforcement.
Exactly. They're celebrating right now.
They're celebrating. A medium-sized celebration.
And maybe they'll launch terrorist activity against your blogging heads redoubt, which is no doubt fortified against the attack from Eleanor Clifton. Let's stop this metaphor, sir.
Whenever you want to.
We're moving on. To a not unrelated subject, which is, what should the Democrats' message on national security be?
Quite related, yes.
John Dickerson had an interesting article in Slate, which I didn't like the first time I read it, and the second time I read it, I liked it a lot more, pointing out that it's totally legitimate to use fear-mongering in politics. That's what politics is all about. If you know, the Republicans say, if you elect us, fewer Americans will die, and the Democrats are allowed to say, if you elect us, fewer Americans will die. And it seems to me that the general, you know, Democratic message is not that far from coalescing, and it's sinking in, which is we've pissed off all these people who are now coming at us. That seems pretty clear. It doesn't seem to me that's even an innovation anymore.
No, but it's hard to sell the message in terms of what your policy is. Okay, what are you going to do when you take power?
Well, there are two problems. There's one which is the specific problem of Iraq, where Democratic vagueness reflects an honest difference in policy. In other words, Democrats could be honest and say the Iraq war was a mistake, but now, you know, they've made such a botch of it that it's, you know, we can't just pull out. The problem is that position is not in any way unanimous or even the majority position within the Democratic Party. They have a serious dispute over policy, over what to do. Should we pull out or should we stay? And it seems to me that's a close question.
Yeah, I mean, what the Democrats should focus on is just we shouldn't have gone in. There are honest disagreements on how you get out of the mess that the Republicans created.
Well,
that should be their line.
That's not enough, because voters have to know what you're going to do when you're in power.
Well, they do, but maybe there's no single-party line, and it's not the focus of any Democratic, you know, message or ads or anything. I mean, I have a question, Dickerson raised the question of, you know, should the Democrats do fear-mongering? I think absolutely. I mean, it's valid. It's the reason I think that the Bush policy is so misguided and so disserves our interests is that I think they've made it more likely that 5, 10, 15 years out, Americans will die. What's difficult, one thing that's difficult about the message is that I do think that it's in the long term that the threat is most grave, because I think it's more plausible they're going to have true weapons of mass destruction many years out, and so the hatred you're creating now will only slowly manifest itself in truly massive lethality and so on. That's a hard thing to convey, and yet it's the reason you are advocating a certain amount of restraint now.
Why do you have to convey it? The misperception of an immediate threat works to your advantage.
No,
makes
no,
people...
no, but see, the problem is the perception of an immediate threat is what leads to the overreaction that increases the long-term threat. That's why, I mean, the real challenge of a message that won't just help the Democrats win office, but would actually lead to benign policy, the real challenge is conveying that sometimes tactical restraint is what makes sense.
I think the perception of a short-term threat does lead to tactical restraint, at least directly to Peggy Noonan's concept of, you know, let's call a timeout, let's have a pause in the war on terror, let's calm down, everybody... not make such a big deal of it. It's also reflected in Fowles' plan to declare victory.
Yeah.
And it seems to me that has tremendous appeal. I mean, Noonan even argues that it has appeal among Republicans.
Yeah, well, tactical restraint
Bush has
is...
just been making too much history for even Republicans to stomach.
Yeah, well, I mean, if you can sell the message, fine, but it seems to be part of the real message. Again, this is not necessarily what gets you elected, but the smart thing to do is to understand that the short-term threats we're talking about are just not that massive. I mean, you know, I did the math, at least in my head, and, you know, it's like 750 million times a year an American gets on an airplane, okay? So let's suppose that this plot had been wildly successful, and they had taken down all 10 planes, and there were like 300 Americans on each plane or whatever. Okay, so that will have been 5 years since 9/11, and they did that. So, okay, suppose they could do that every 5 years.
Bob, nobody will buy this math. People are wildly over-averse to small risks of catastrophic events.
But I'm saying if we're going to handle this risk intelligently, we're going to have to get people to get things in proportion. You can appeal somewhat to people's rational minds. Let me...
Why is it irrational to want to calm things down and not stir the hornet's nest?
No, that part is rational, Mickey, but I'm saying you can say that and people can buy Peggy Noonan's message and then people say, oh, we might have lost 10 airplanes, so let's ban liquids and do ethnic profiling, which makes things worse. That's what I'm talking about.
The liquids might get angry. I mean, why can't we...
Banning liquids is taken as positive reinforcement by the terrorists. I mean, when they see us massively inconvenienced, that is a kind of victory for the terrorists.
But it also sort of has solidaristic virtues for our side. It sort of reminds us we're all in the same boat and we should be on the lookout. So even if it's not intentional, an intentional effect by Bush, it has sort of it has a downside for Al-Qaeda, too. Doesn't
it? I mean, but what, Americans bonding over thirst in coach class, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah. I think that'll be...
I think that's
our ace in the hole. That's our hidden asset in the war on terror, is Americans bonding over thirst in coach. But, you know...
I saw a lot of bonding.
I have one final... Maybe it's not final. But I've decided I'm serious. Remember last time on the tactical restraint front? I brought out the Zidane image.
Right.
Okay, the soccer player headbutted the guy, and arguably morally justified, right? The guy's talking about his mother, fine, but it's just not smart. I can actually imagine an effective video, not necessarily for a Democrat who's running for office, but just, you know, sponsored by some, you know, coalition for a mature foreign policy or something that says... that, like, shows the guy talking to him and says, you know, sometimes aggression or sometimes retaliation is morally justified or aggression is morally justified. Shows Zidane headbutting the guy, and the announcer says, that doesn't mean it's a good idea, but still retaliation isn't necessarily smart or something. Shows the Italian celebrating, and then, like, closes with footage of Bush saying, like, the famous bring it on, or bring them on, or whatever the quote is.
He's apologized for that one.
Yeah, well, whatever. Well, we wouldn't include that part in this ad. And then the announcer just says something like, it's time to put grown-ups in charge of foreign policy. I think that could be effective.
I just don't think there are enough soccer fans.
Oh, that became a universal symbol, didn't it?
Yeah, but probably less so in America than elsewhere.
Well, anyway... if anybody wants to put together one of those ads with Windows Movie Maker,
The other problem Democrats have is that if they were in charge, they wouldn't do a lot of things. A lot of them wouldn't do a lot of things like involving wiretapping of phones and enforcing the Patriot Act that might help forestall these threats. So they have a policy problem there too, I think.
Maybe.
But Dickerson has some crazy argument that they should, the Democrats don't need to convince people that they'd be better in power, only that, like, one house, it would be good if they shared responsibility with Bush, which seems to me is the worst of both worlds. Then we can't have a timeout, because then the Democrats are tarred with the same brush as Bush. We want a situation where the Democrats can come into power and say, okay, things have changed now. It's a new United States. Give us a second, even if it's bogus, the rebranding idea. Give us a second look. This isn't the Bush administration anymore. And we're not the arrogant, aggressive Yankee cowboys, et cetera, et cetera.
So you think it's in the Democrats' interest for the Republicans to retain control?
I just don't think it's a big advantage. No, because I don't think they really will share responsibility. But if they were co-governors and perceived as co-governors around the world, then that might happen.
Well, but one argument you hear is that then they can hold hearings that will embarrass the Bush administration if they control one of the houses.
That's a good point. Does the Bush administration need any more embarrassing? I mean, Jesus.
There's never enough of that for me.
It's about as embarrassed as you can get.
I don't really necessarily buy that argument, because for one thing, I think those are kind of transparently self-serving sometimes.
Well, they'll start talking about impeachment, and they'll turn people off, and...
No, I think there's danger of them overplaying, but...
Yeah.
I don't know. It remains a challenge how you get the I say fear-mongering, fine, it's valid, it's true, but there's a lot of subtlety about how the message has to be conveyed about in particular about tactical restraint, and why retaliation, even when warranted, is not always a good idea. I don't think you'd want to put it like that, even.
Well, it's hard to come up. It's hard to even come up with like this timeout or pause or.
Yeah, timeout sounds kind of weak.
Yeah,
see, that's what I like about the Zidane thing, you know.
Well, that's what's good about Fowles' declaring victory thing too.
Well, see,
it gives a positive cover for what is essentially a, hey, we made too much of this from the beginning.
I heard him talk on the radio about the piece, which I had never really read in full, and everything made sense to me because he emphasizes tactical restraint, except the idea of declaring victory. As I said last time, anybody who declares victory in the war on terror risks looking like a fool tomorrow when there's some big foil plot.
Aside from that essential lie, it's a shrewd political move. I agree.
We should move on to Iowa so you can do a rant.
Well, the Democrats this week pushed their plan to... add to the Iowa caucuses and New Hampshire primaries two other contests. After the Iowa caucuses will come the Nevada caucuses, and right after the New Hampshire primary will come the South Carolina primary. And I sort of like this idea because it might lead to the demise of a really terrible institution, the Iowa caucuses. Let's face it, and this is sort of a moose point, the Iowa caucuses have been a bad thing for America. Not only, first, they've had terrible judgment. They've given us, most recently, John Kerry. That was a great move. Great, great judgment by the voters of Iowa to think that this guy was the best Democratic candidate. They gave us Michael Dukakis. They've, you know, the only good thing that the Iowa caucuses did was Gary Hart finished second in 1984, and that gave him a little boost to New Hampshire. Aside from that, the Iowa caucuses have been a total bust in terms of helping the Democrats get power. And the second thing is, it's a lousy election. It's they don't know how to count the ballots. We still don't know who won in 1984. It's this crazy system where they divide up in corners of the room, and then they don't even try to count them, but the networks try to count them. It's an election where nobody knows the result. And yet the news organizations make a huge big deal. They all move there. They all crowd the bar at the hotel. Time magazine in 1988 had a whole cover of Iowa as if it was like the most important thing in the world. The hell with it. Let's get rid of it. They're nice people. They have terrible judgment. They're a bunch of nice liberal teachers who are peaceniks, who are exactly the people we don't want deciding who the Democratic nominee is. Let's move it to a state with good Democratic values like Nevada. Unionism and legalized prostitution.
So that's what's going to happen, right?
Well, there's some argument that because there'll be these four right together, that it will somehow magnify the power of Iowa.
So they're going to be what four? Now to remove
Iowa,
the curse
Nevada,
of Iowa, the disproportionate influence of Iowa, they're going to put, on the same day, they're going to have Iowa, Nevada.
Not the same day, in rapid succession.
Okay.
Iowa, Nevada, New Hampshire, and then South Carolina. And the last two are primaries, the first two are caucuses. People have argued that because Iowa is first, whoever they pick, you know, if they pick Kerry again, he'll sweep all four. And I think that ignores the filer faster principle. There was a very interesting quote from the South Carolina guy saying, these four primaries strung out over a two-week period. Well, you know, 10 years ago you would have laughed at somebody saying that four primaries over a two-year period was strung out. With modern rapid communications, there's a lot of time in the 4 days, you know, between one caucus and another for people to have second thoughts. Do we really want John Kerry, et cetera, et cetera? So I'm not sure that it will magnify Iowa's...
I think they should have several on one night at the beginning just to dilute the influence of each. And they should be geographically balanced.
That would be good, but Iowa and New Hampshire won't stand for it.
What kind of special leverage do they hold?
Well, New Hampshire controls the state government controls the date of its primary, not the Democratic Party, and they've already said we may move it up even further and screw the Democrats.
Well, but can't any other state move it up even beyond then?
But they don't have, they're not as eager to do it as New Hampshire. I mean, New Hampshire has a state law requiring it be the first of the nation primary. They're willing to go to extremes that other states.
So you're worried that Nevada is like, is bringing, you know.
Yes.
What? What into the picture?
The Democrats is the party of sin.
Well, symbolically, maybe, but I think actual residents of Nevada are not especially themselves prone to gambling and patronizing prostitutes, right? I mean, in terms of the voters.
That's right. They just, their economy is based
on providing gambling and prostitutes, right?
To others, yes. It's heavily unionized, and you sort of don't trust Nevada to be the most honest state in terms of counting ballots.
Oh, come on, Mickey.
Especially caucuses, where there's always a little fudge factor anyway.
Mickey.
There aren't actual ballots.
Mickey,
have
you ever been to Nevada?
I have.
You ever been to Las Vegas?
I have. It's incredibly depressing.
What's the worst thing you did there?
What is the worst thing I did there? I saw Steve Martin's art collection at the Bellagio Hotel.
Well, see, you just didn't immerse yourself in the spirit of Las Vegas. You're supposed to do something bad.
Yeah, I did. I tried.
But I'm sorry, I changed the subject. You didn't even gamble?
I may have played one slot machine.
Mickey.
I hate gambling, and the places are so depressing, you never want to gamble again.
It depends. The strip is different from downtown.
Which is worse?
Well, back in the day when I went, downtown was lower socioeconomic status gamblers than the strip.
I went to the highest rent hotels on the strip, and they were also still incredibly depressing.
Some people find the scene depressing, yes. Some people revel in it.
Anyway, Nevada's probably not the best state, but Harry Reid, the majority leader, wanted it. And anything to kill off Iowa is my
lot. Okay, so you're bonding with Nevada.
I'd rather have courthouse wranglers in Nevada than school teachers in Iowa.
I guess I'm with you. I would just rather have the whole thing diffused so no one state has...
Another reason why it doesn't help Iowa that much is because the media is going to have to spread itself all over, four states instead of camping out in Des Moines.
Fine with me.
I agree.
Mickey, not to change the subject, but have you ever noticed how whenever we have a big argument, unless your position is just completely indefensible, like defending Ann Coulter, the email overwhelmingly supports you and is against me?
I don't notice that. A lot of people have been saying that, that your superior intellect and reasoning power have been...
But that's a good example, because arguing otherwise would be indefensible. So that's consistent with the principle I just laid out, don't you think?
I don't understand.
I'm joking. It's a joke.
Okay.
Anyway, and certainly in this last case where we discussed kausism...
Yeah.
And whether or not you're evil. I mean, the email was overwhelming. Here's one. I, for one, love Mickey, and I think his is a rare and valuable treasure. The reason is the insight. And, of course, we're discussing the fact, I was criticizing you for, we'll get into that. But it has to do with your tendency to criticize Democrats and yet claim you're a Democrat, to overwhelmingly criticize Democrats.
Right, you think what the world needs is another lockstep pro-democratic blog attacking the Bush administration.
Something like that. Oh, here's a guy who writes, Mr. Kaus, keep doing what you do. Without critical self-examination, the Democratic Party goes nowhere. Shake those haters off. You do it well. And you do that well, possibly because you've had so much opportunity to practice, but for whatever reason, you do shake haters off well.
But this is a self-selected group. The people that hate me are all on Mark Kleiman's page.
Well, I was going to say these fans who wrote into us, they should go to Kevin Drum's blog and dilute the unrelenting stream of anti-Cal sentiment that appended itself to his last, Don't you think?
That'd be nice.
Where were these? There was one guy, Tom something, who showed up on both. And then here's what they're saying about me in this very context. If Bob doesn't stop shouting and generally acting like a jerk, I'm going to stop listening. I really do think that thinking too much about evolutionary psychology has eroded his morality and civility. That is a slur on evolutionary psychology. And in truth, I was even worse before evolutionary psychology. It is a...
I knew you back then.
Yeah,
it was
right.
Awful.
I'm better now, right?
I actually didn't know you before evolutionary psychology.
No, you didn't. But believe me, I was worse. No, it's true. It's a misconception that thinking in Darwinian terms...
That must have been when you were gambling in Las Vegas. Before evolutionary psychology.
Actually, I don't even remember before evolutionary psychology. It goes back. But anyway, if I had time, I would defend it as a morally edifying worldview, which it actually at least can be. And I have failed to put the principles into practice in my own life, I concede. This guy writes to me, "You became uncharacteristically unmoored in your criticism of Mickey." Now, Mickey, would you say it's uncharacteristic of me to be unmoored?
No, I thought that was very characteristic.
Okay, so he's wrong too.
Nor do you yell, you just keep on talking forever.
Beg your pardon?
You're not a yeller.
I get animated.
You're locked into this academic thing where you just talk in whole paragraphs.
No, I get animated much more than academics do, and okay. to my disadvantage. Let me just, I mean, and then there's a people who I think characterize my views in ways that I would not. Robert's insistence that all on the left must follow the party line, not exactly the way I'd put it. Let me take a quick stab, we're a little late on time, at characterizing my... one of the main things I'm saying about you is that there is there's some kind of disconnect somewhere within you. You've got some kind of split personality disorder, okay? I mean, I think the typical person is like me, where kind of the cognition and the emotion more or less fit together. In other words, the arguments I put forth lead to the conclusion, if you accept them, that Bush is bad. I say I want Bush defeated. And you can tell from my affect that it's really true. I really was depressed after he won re-election, okay? Whereas with you, the arguments you dwell on in your blog would lead one to believe that you support Bush. You profess to support Kerry. And yet it's clear that your affect, effectively, you actually just don't like Kerry. Because it's not just this stuff about how you're playing military police and you're shoring up, you know, democratic policies, you know, and attacking their weak spots so we can get everything.
Well,
in shape.
I said as soon as I said the word military police, I also said that was not. I didn't think that was an
okay.
Adequate
but Mickey, would
defense.
You? The point is, it's not about policy. How much time did you spend spreading the idea?
I completely accept the idea that emotionally I enjoy attacking Democrats more than I enjoy attacking Republicans.
Okay, would you explain
so
that for
us? So should
me. Would you explain that for us? What's going on?
My formative politics were reacting against the failed liberalism of the Carter years and the welfare debate when the conservatives were right and the liberals were wrong.
But
and I was happy to have Tom DeLay there, and the Republicans were the allies of the right thing, along with Clinton, and the Democrats were idiots.
But Mickey,
tomorrow... On Tuesday, we celebrate the 10th anniversary of the Democratic idiots being beaten.
But, Mickey, as some readers have pointed out, many of those battles had been won. Welfare reform happened. The unions have much less of a hold over the party, and on and on. And yet you still remain locked in this 1983 mindset. And let me just elaborate.
You liked John Kerry. You were enthusiastic about him. You were like all gung-ho for John Kerry.
Oh, I very much disliked him as a person, but I reached the rational conclusion that he would be better for the country than Bush.
Well, I came to the same conclusion, too, but was your...
But in my case, the affect was with it, Mickey. I was really depressed when Bush won. And here's one thing I wasn't doing. I mean, you're acting as if this is all about policy, which is nonsense. How much time did you spend trying to spread the idea that Kerry had received Botox treatment, okay? That was a very useful corrective for a misguided Democratic Party, Mickey. And just recently in the last...
I don't think I spent a lot of time, and it was a lot of fun.
Fine, but you could have had just as much fun finding something about Bush, but you never do.
I had a lot of fun with Bush's cocaine use back in 2000. I wrote much more about Bush and cocaine than I did about Kerry and Botox.
I remember that, but I applaud you for it. But the final...
I'll link to it.
The final example for me is Clinton, who ideologically is, you know... reasonably close to you. He's a guy who did welfare reform, centrist Democrat. And just a few months ago, you got obsessed with the idea that he was part of a big scandal involving this Burkle guy, and you flacked it to death. And there was nothing there. But why did you want to do it? There was nothing there. The facts weren't on your side. Why did you do it?
Well, the night is young, Bob.
Yeah, the night is young. That's what you were saying 3 months ago.
Well, it's still young. Clinton's wife is running for president, and if she runs for president, we'll find out more.
You should tar her in advance with the misbehavior of her husband. Now I see.
I'm a blogger, and I'm indicating to people where potential scandals lie.
Oh, you're trying to defuse the scandal in advance.
No, I'm just saying what I think the truth is. I think the truth is that Burkle character is bad news, and the Clinton's association with Burkle will not help his wife's campaign.
Okay.
Even the front page of the New York Times confirms that.
No, it actually didn't. You sent me the link to that story and said, see, I was right. It's a huge scandal. And I got the email. You said, this is big. I read the story. It's like, no, you're imagining this. You're hallucinating. And indeed, the story did not spawn a bunch of other stories about what a big scandal this was.
I agree it was a weak story.
But at the time, you wrote me saying it was big.
But it raises the issue of Clinton's womanizing.
Oh, yeah, that has not gotten enough airplay.
Well, but, you know, Hillary's right not to want it in her face and given extra publicity by Clinton associating with a carefree bachelor like Ron Burkle.
Well, I wish we weren't so running so late, because I would like to, because first of all, two of our viewers raised a very astute question that I'm afraid I don't have time to answer.
What's the astute question?
Well, I've said that it bothered me that Lieberman once said that Democrats should not criticize Bush, but I've also said that you should stop criticizing Kerry, which I didn't say, but anyway. Something,
I think you just said it.
Something like that. I said your ratio of Bush to Kerry criticism should more reflect your professed ideology. So isn't there a contradiction here? I think not, but we don't have time to get to that. We'll have to get to it next time.
I don't think so either, but I'll think about it.
No, but it's a good question. It's a pretty subtle question. It's not easy to dismiss, and two people independently arrived at it. Such is the caliber of our viewers. Finally, Mickey, quickly, on another email front. Here's one that says, hey, blogging head guys, I'm an occasional viewer, listener of your dialogues. But I've noticed that while I'm very drawn to your dialogue titles, they always seem witty and thought-provoking, the dialogues themselves are rather boring. What's up with that? Should I just read the titles? What would you say, Mickey? What would your advice be?
That's also true of most magazines, is that the packaging is better than what's inside.
Good comeback.
But, you know, I is it boring once people appreciate the subtleties of your complex personality?
No, I think we have a few viewers who are fascinated.
Then it becomes a compelling drama.
Fascinated by the interplay. Very quickly, here's somebody who saw the site after hearing me plug it on Radio Times, an NPR show in Philadelphia. And
cool.
And that will give me an opportunity to link to that episode of Radio Times featuring me. That's the reason I say it. Finally, do you remember the woman who wrote you offering lighting advice?
Yeah, the one you wanted to fix me up with.
Elizabeth Kay, I didn't put it that way. She said she had friends who could help you with the lighting. It wasn't necessarily her.
Actually, Elizabeth Kay was her name? I know somebody named Elizabeth Kay. Go ahead.
No, the initial was Kay.
Oh, okay.
It's not...
Okay, yeah.
It doesn't have like a cosmetics line or anything. Anyway, it turns out she knows whereof she speaks, and when it turns out... comes to lighting, she actually has a film in the a short film in the Palm Springs Film Festival called, depending on YASIN, which I guess could be Yasin or Yasin or any number of things. So we'll link to that.
The prestigious Palm Springs Film Festival.
Exactly, we'll link to that. And also, you know, if it's short enough, why don't we just run it on Blogging Heads? Has somebody asked Elizabeth Kay about that?
Let's not go there. It could be awful.
Could be. You're right.
Okay.
Still, I mean, we could run it. There could be like a secondary place on the site where we run stuff in the that's somewhere between, you know, great and not quite awful.
We haven't even gotten it together to have a comment section yet.
That's coming soon.
Okay.
And we have no reason to believe that this film is awful.
No, it might be great.
Might be great.
I just think it's a pig in the poke. We don't know.
What does that metaphor? Oh, yeah, we don't. It means we don't know.
Yeah.
Okay. I take it. No, I don't know. I guess I take it back.
I'll spend the next interval.
I think somewhere in our future, though, lies like viewer-generated video.
Cool.
Of some sort.
That'd be cool.
Yeah.
You know, move over YouTube.
Precisely.
Cool.
Okay. It's been a long one.
Okay, yep.
See you around.
See you soon. I'll contemplate your hypocrisy between now and the next time we meet.
There aren't enough people doing that. I wish you would.
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks.
See ya.
See ya.